So now the next other part of the Gemara, after we talk about the section, Rabbi Yehoshua ben Levi gives another lesson regarding Mount Sinai. What happened? So when Moshe Rabbeinu, Sha'ala Moshe le'Marom, when Moshe Rabbeinu ascended to the heavenly heights, he went to Shamayim. His body stayed here, his neshama went up there. The angels went to Hashem, and they said, what is this someone that's born of a woman doing among us? This is a human being doing here. So Hashem says to them, he came here to get the Torah for me. So the angels immediately became defensive.
Yeah, they were jealous.
They said, the Torah? The Holy Torah that was here 974 generations before them? Before the world, before you created the world, you created the Torah for 974 generations. It existed. Before anything else, you were studying and learning and doing everything in the Torah by yourself for 974 generations. You held it in this treasure. Your greatest treasure of all. You gave it to them. The ones that were made out of dust, out of sand. What do they know about the Torah? How could they even connect to the Torah, to the heavenly parts of the Torah, to the secrets? So the angels, Chazal is explaining, were really mostly worried about the secrets part of the Torah, the mystical stuff. So then, Hashem says to Moshe Rabbeinu, give them an answer. No, answer them. Moshe Rabbeinu steps back. He says, Hashem, if I answer them, I'm afraid that they're going to burn me. They're all, each one of these angels is the size of the world, and they're all fire. It's like I'm scared they're going to burn me with their fire, with their holiness. It's angels. People think angels are like little Star Wars robots. Fire. Sometimes they look, you know, people, NASA and different organizations have these amazing pictures of the cosmos, different stars and different things that, you know, are in the world, in the universe. And once in a while, I mean, if you look carefully, you can see faces. I don't know if it's necessarily faces. To me, it looks like faces. There's many things that look like faces in the cosmos. And mamash, you see what Rabbi Akiva says in one of the Midrashim. Amar Rabbi Akiva, chaya achat omedet barakia ushma Yisrael. There's one of the holy creations that Hashem made, one of the angels that Hashem made. It's in the Rakia, it's in the middle of the sky, and its name is Israel. V'chakuka mitzra Yisrael, and its name that's engraved in its forehead is Israel. And what does it do all day? It says, in the right time, Baruchu et Hashem mevorach. It tells, screams out into the universe, blessed Hashem. And all of the angels says, Hashem is blessed. That's his job. And he says, this angel is in the middle of the universe somewhere. Now we're thinking angel. If we still think like idiots, that's a little Star Wars guy in the middle of the sky, like, oh, we could see it. But when you start thinking these giant stars are angels, imagine one of these giant stars, I mean, it's mamash, the size of 1,000 Earths. It's one angel. The sun is an angel. Sun is an angel that commands it. The earth is an angel that runs it. One angel. So he's thinking one of these angels in the middle of the heavens screaming, bless the Shem! Who's going to say no? So Moshe Rabbeinu is scared over here. He's saying, Hashem, I'm scared to say something. They're going to burn me. So Hashem Yitbarach says to him, hold on to my throne, I'll protect you. So Moshe Rabbeinu says, how could the Torah be yours? Torah says, Anochi Hashem Elokecha, Asher Otzeticha Meretz Mitzrayim. I am Hashem your God, who has taken you out of the land of Egypt. This is the first commandment out of 10. Did you go to Egypt? He asked the angels. Did you go to Egypt? Were you slaves in Egypt? And then it continues, Velo yelecha Elohim acherim. You shall not have other gods. Second commandment. Because you have anybody that you live amongst the Christians, the Catholics, the Arabs, the Buddhists, whoever, that have idol worship. You have them here in Shamayim? You have them? No, they're all in a different section. They're not there. So what are you worried about idol worship? Who's what angel is idol worshiping? Obviously, this mitzvah is not relevant to you. He says, Zachor et Yom HaShabbat. Lekadsho, remember the Shabbat. Remember the holiness of the Shabbat. Is it even possible for you to violate Shabbat as an angel? Can you even violate Shabbat as an angel? If you have a melacha that you're doing on Shabbat, what are you going to do, right? What are you going to sew in Shamayim? You're going to make a sweater for each other? What are you going to do? Can you even do a melacha? What else it says? Shuv maketiv ba, lo tisa. It says you shall not take the name of Hashem in vain. Which is really the third commandment, not the fourth, but it skips here. It says, is there masa umatan benechem? You have business between you? How do you take Hashem's name in vain? You swear on Hashem's name. In the old days, when they would do business, they'd shake hands. A handshake used to mean something. Today, it's just a formality. Today, it's just a formality. It means absolutely nothing. Somebody could shake your hand while he's stabbing you in the back. While he's stabbing you in the back, it hurts. He's smiling at you the whole time. It hurts? Yeah, good? Okay. $900 an hour. $900 an hour. While he's shaking your hand. Thank you. He's shaking your hand, he's stealing everything you have. Shaking your hand. In the old days, shake a hand meant something. In the old days, the Jews, Am Yisrael, used to swear in Hashem's name when they would do business. You're going to buy this, I'm going to buy this. Swear. Swear in Hashem's name. You vow in Hashem's name. Meaning that if you cheat the other guy, it's not just cheating the guy. You desecrate Hashem's name. It's not just cheating the guy that you have to come back in a Gilgul. You're going to Gehenom for that. You desecrated Hashem's name. You swore and you didn't mean it. You used Hashem's name like a joke. Like it's one of your friends in the bar. Something wrong with you? So that's what happens. He says, you swear in Hashem's name. Is there even business among you angels? You angels do business that you have to swear in Hashem's name? And he continues, Kabel tavicha ve't imecha. Respect your parents. You have parents? You don't have any parents. And he says, Lo tirzach, lo tinaf, lo tignov. Don't commit adultery, don't murder, don't steal, don't be jealous. None of these mitzvot are relevant to you as angels. So obviously, when Hashem wrote the Torah 974 generations before He created us, obviously He had us in mind. The angels immediately fell in love with Moshe Rabbeinu. When? After they said to Hashem, you made, obviously, master of the universe, how grand is your name. Obviously, you already thought about this before we even thought about a question. You already had answers. And everybody became a friend of Moshe Rabbeinu. And because they insulted him initially, they each gave him a gift. How did they insult him initially? They said, what is a man, the son of a woman, somebody that came from a human being? What's he doing among us? We're angels, we're fire, the size of stars and suns. What are you little guy doing here? You came from a tipas rucha, you came from a sperm cell. You're among us. They say they felt bad now. This is not a regular person. This is Holy of Holies, Moshe Rabbeinu. Moshe Rabbeinu. They all gave him a gift. Each one gave him two gifts as a consolation. So now, the Rabbi Yehoshua ben Levi continues, and he says one of those angels was the Satan himself. And he gave him a gift. What did he give him a gift? He gave him a gift of how to stop a major decree by Hashem Yitbarach of death. And he used it actually in the Torah when it says that Aaron HaKohen, when Hashem put a decree on Am Yisrael, we're going to read about it in a couple of weeks, where he put a plague on Am Yisrael, all the snakes that were biting them. And he told Moshe Rabbeinu, make yourself a snake out of bronze, make everybody else look at them. But to stop the plague, what happened? Aaron had to separate, go in between the living and the dead. Meaning he had to stop the plague by doing what? Using the secret that Moshe Rabbeinu learned from the Satan himself. So this Gemara continues, it's on 89 already. Bishah שירד משה מלפני הקדוש ברוך הוא, בא שטן ואמר לפניו, ריבונו של עולם, תורה, איכני? So at the time that Moshe Rabbeinu already left Shemayim, went down with the Torah, Satan came, said, where's the Torah? Why is he worried about the Torah? Well, he didn't know. What happened?
When
Moshe comes, Satan knows, Gemara in Brachot says, Barati Satan, Barati Yetzara, Barati Torah Tavlin. I created a Yetzara, but I created a potion, the only thing I could kill him. He's bigger than you, smarter than you, older than you, more experienced than you, everything better than you. But there's only one thing that can beat him, it's my Torah. So as soon as the Satan realized, you just gave him a secret weapon, it's like, where is he? He started asking the sky, the earth, all the other angels, where is this Torah? Finally, he gets to Moshe Rabbeinu. He goes, where's the Torah? He goes, I don't have it. So Hashem says, Moshe, what are you, a little fibber? That's a white lie, you have it. I give you the Torah. So Moshe Rabbeinu says, Master of the universe, חמודה גנוזה יש לך שאתה משתעשע בה בכל יום. אני אחזיק טובה לעצמי. You have coveted the treasure Torah that you delight every day. And I should flatter myself that you gave it to me. I should say, this greatest treasure that you have and that ever existed. The world was created for the Torah. Not for any other reason. Let's not get confused. Everybody thinks the world was created for the Jews. It wasn't created for the Jews. Created for the Torah. If Am Yisrael went to Mount Sinai, Bar Minan, Chas V'Shalom, and decided not to accept the Torah, Hashem would destroy the world. Not if the Torah didn't accept Am Yisrael. If Am Yisrael went to Mount Sinai, said no, Hashem would destroy the world. Or you could easily give it to a different nation. And someone else would be Am Yisrael. Meaning that the purpose of the world is to fulfill the Torah. So Moshe Rabbeinu says the whole purpose of the world is this Torah. It's your greatest treasure. And you want me to go say to people, oh, I have the greatest treasure? Ma pitom, who am I bichlal? Amar lo HaKadosh Baruch Hu. That's a humble person. Hashem liked it so much, and he said, since you minimize yourself so humble, since you diminished yourself, I'll call that Torah by your name. Torah Moshe. That's why it's called Five Books of Moses. And then the last part of this particular story, and then we'll move on to different things. Oh, actually, this is a different one. The other one doesn't have much to do with it. But I gave you a synopsis, not all the details of the details. But when you read this Gemara, I don't know, to me, I got mamash, I felt like a little piece of Gan Eden, that mamash you connect to the Torah, you see the relationship between Hashem and Moshe Rabbeinu. Say, Moshe, you little fibber, you have the Torah, what are you lying to the Satan for? Misken, the guy's looking for the Torah, he's asking the Shamayim, he's asking the Aretz, he's going crazy, you have the secret weapon, he's looking for it, you're telling him you don't have it, you have it, you don't have to worry about nothing, you have it already. Just the relationship they have was something amazing. Something really, truly amazing.